atmosphere, passion, and excitement. And we have something really interesting that's going to happen now. If you've noticed, there's been a face that's popped in a couple times on our screen. He is one of our key partners with Verizon. You know, we have over 70,000 devices that run on the Verizon network as a true partner that's coming in. And Toby, we are excited that you're here. We know that you are bringing a whole bunch of dynamic excitement. Now, if you look at his resume, which is online, he's done everything except launch the space shuttle. I think they're bringing him back for the Mars mission. Are you going to go on the Mars mission or just help set it up? I'm not sure which way it's going to go, but we're hoping you're going to stick around with us. You know, but the network is so important as to how we carry, and 5G coming up. There is so much that's happening with the work you're doing. Dr. Vega, do you want to add anything to this? Toby, we're going to bat it over to you for a keynote. Toby Redshaw. Toby, thank you for being here. It's a privilege to have you as our speaker.
Thanks. Thanks very much for having me. I've got a short presentation that we put together. Hopefully, somebody on the other side has got that and is going to pop that up on the screen. Here we go. That looks looks like we're getting there. So I'm going to blast through a presentation. I'm going to talk about how this is a really amazing, unique time of change, more change than I've seen technologically and business-wise in over 30 years of doing this. I'm going to drill down into the fourth industrial revolution, kind of demystify that, tell you why that's important, go deeper below that, demystify and sort of make a simple case about, look, this is what 5G really is. This is why it's different. And then talk about the impact and talk about the things that we're doing together and echo some of the things I heard in the panel just now about why it's a unique time for partnering. So if we jump to the first slide, please. So it's more business wave change than I've seen in a long time. Jump to the next slide and it'll list these out. It's not just business change waves that are happening, but also technology, and they're coming together at the same time. If you take me to the next slide. There we go. So some of these are things you'll recognize that you've seen before that started, some of them started 10 years ago and are starting to accelerate. Companies in the big B2B to space are trying to be in the B2B to C space, CPG companies, automotive, everybody wants to get closer to the customer. Developments in IoT and AI and connectivity are all improving that. People that make really big things, you know, big expensive things like locomotives, jet engines, combine harvesters, they're moving from selling assets into a service model, selling service and selling impact. We believe all sales will start to include experience, and experience will become a hugely important part of that. We believe you'll start to see AR layers into that. And then you'll have, and I think this is really important for healthcare, you'll have a very cogent longitudinal story or narrative about your engagement, not only vertically through healthcare, but horizontally with your peer community. We believe there'll be snackable digital assets and commerce attached to that. I'll talk about the fourth industrial revolution in detail in a minute. We also think that one of the accelerators is the Legoization of technology, especially the low code, no code wave that's hitting. And then also the Legoization of AI and the ability to do AI without deep AI skills. The dark side of this is all of these have been adopted by the dark web. There's been some real big structural changes over the last decade there to an asset light model, leading edge technology. It's maybe one of the most Darwinian environments I've ever seen. Of course, it's Darwin for negative purposes. I think the short version is the next 3 years of hacking is going to make the last decade look like kindergarten. So that's maybe one of the darker waves that's happening, but all of this is coming together at the same time. So let's jump into the fourth industrial revolution. I'll give you a little explanation of that and what we think is happening there and why that's going to have huge impact. If you jump to the next slide for me. So three things about this, right? This came out of the World Economic Forum and the very clever people at Davos. There's been lots of work across many industries on this. Lots of folks call this Industry 4.0 or Healthcare 4.0. Basically, it's three things. It's a really big deal, right? The last three industrial revolutions changed the world. So very smart people believe this is of that magnitude. Second item is that this is a 4, 5, 6 year transformation, not decades like the last three. And the third thing to remember is this is not a rising tide that brings up old boats. There were, in the past industrial revolutions, there were winners and losers across sectors, inside sectors, by geography. The big difference on this one, besides the cycle time, is this one is purely technological. It's driven by five technologies creating a flywheel effect that's going to deliver new platforms. We've done a lot of analysis on this. There's a lot of analysis out there. And the short version is, this just basically boils down to operations, customer engagement, customer life cycle value. Whether you're in a for-profit or not-profit environment, we believe all of those processes and structures with the new technologies become proactive and predictive and preventative and pattern matched and permissioned and peer connected and precise. Now imagine, you know, we're in the distant future, like the end of next year, and which healthcare center do you want to go to? The 7Ps one or the not 7Ps one? Which airport do you want to go to? Which company do you want to invest in? Which one do you want to be a customer of? Having a better operational cost structure and a better customer engagement and customer experience, especially over time with a better lifecycle value for customers, that's all business really is, right? So this is seriously at the core of competitiveness and comparative benefit. Because this stuff is all digital, you also get this thing that we call evolutionary intelligence, that it's sloughing off all of this data. We've got several examples already, offline, I could talk to you about a really clever one that was built out at Columbia Medical with stroke therapy going into VR. But you can monitor all of the data and the metadata. And then at the end of the month or the end of the week, basic ML comes back and says, hey, you know, I've looked at all of your data, all of your metadata, all of the process data, and here's a couple of patterns that are really interesting that you should look at. And I found these three new clusters that somebody should go dig in on. And oh, by the way, here are these anomalies, and here's a couple of preventative items that if you just put in triggers, you can solve this, right? So not only is it fundamentally better, but it's also a increased agility and a continually improving level of intelligence. So if you jump to the next slide, I'll start to explain how this really works. So this graph looks nuts from one perspective, right? If you look at today and look backwards at that graph, you go, wait, hang on a minute. AI, big data, cloud, AR, VR, they have all grown tremendously over the last 10 years. And that's absolutely true. The point of this slide is when you go 5 years into the future and you look backwards, what we've experienced for the last 10 years will look like the flat part of the curve. You're going to see this giant hockey stick, whether you're looking at it from a scale, utility, adoption, value, or impact perspective, you're going to see this curve move straight up. I'm happy to talk to anybody offline about detailed examples, but take a couple of examples, right? Cloud. 10 years ago, I gave the cloud practitioner lecture at Stanford because there were so few people who had done cloud at an enterprise-wide wide level. They brought me in from a financial services company in London. There was not much going on. 5 years later, which was 5 years ago, we invented containers, five and a half years ago. 10% of cloud enterprise data is in the cloud today. That all feels like the beginning of something. AI, big data, I read a press release about a new platform for big data about 6 weeks ago that said, hey, depending how good you are at big data, this new thing's either 50 to 1,000x better, right? We know technology does this, it very rarely does 50 to 1,000x better. So now imagine these four technologies could exist on a super low latency, fat bandwidth, software-defined, cloud-native, compute at the edge, 1,000x better for IoT density, 10x better for IoT battery life, super resilient network. What would happen? Those four technologies would create a flywheel effect and feed off each other and enable brand new approaches, brand new platforms that will change the world. So I just covered two things there. One, that all that stuff I just said about the network, that is the 5G spec. Two, this is the logic underpinning the fourth industrial revolution. This is why it's going to happen. Now, those four technologies combined on that kind of network will have secondary technologies, and there will be other things attached to that, right? There's some very cool things happening with blockchain, but these are the drivers, and the platforms that come from them are the game changers. So let's jump to the next item. So here's an interesting thing. When you look back across history, commercial history for sure, technological history for sure, but there's a wealth of data in military history also. The really big winners in big paradigm level change moments like today are the ones that looked at the model level and said, I'm going to change the model. I'm not just going to bring in this technology and marginally improve everything I've been doing. I'm going to think differently. Easy to say, actually not super difficult to think through, really hard to execute because the existing ways of doing things have people and egos and political capital all attached to them. That change to model thinking is really, 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 really difficult. Let's jump to the next slide. One of the few audiences where I could bring these two guys and people in the audience might know who they are. That's the father of modern military strategy, von Clausewitz, which means he's the grandfather of business strategy. And that's his disciple there in the mid 1800s, Field Marshal von Moltke, who's the guy who originally said, look, no battle plan survives its first contact with the battlefield. What he did is he changed warfare and dominated in Central Europe for decades because he innovated at the model level. He innovated what a standing army was. He innovated around using rail networks, around using the telegraph, changed the resourcing model, made it actually better and more cost efficient. If you remember what I was talking about earlier in the fourth industrial revolution, and he adopted early what other folks thought were defective, wonky weapons that just happened to have way better output numbers. That was the first bolt action gun, very different than a musket, and used that to dominate that. The thing I want to mention in here, though, when we're talking about designing at a model level and changing strategy, is no amount of great planning or talent or capability will save you from a bad strategy. When Motorola was a combined company, a bad strategy in their mobile device business radically dismembered that business. And of course, Kmart had a terrible strategy, and that ended, no matter how good their tech people were, their talent were, that ended badly. So let's leave our military Prussian friends behind and jump to the next slide. Here's some more relatable examples, right? What Rockefeller did with oil, amazing, gigantic success. He innovated at the model level using two new technologies, the rail network and the telegraph network. And interesting that those were network technologies. Sears, the same story. Uber, the same story. Now, Uber, here's the interesting one, not massively complicated technology, built something simple on top of 4G, but were first to show up to change a model where assets were massively underutilized, where service was very varied, where there was a giant amount of fog between inventory or solutions and consumers. And they came in and said, okay, we're layering some technology and change this model. If you think about advertising to fulfillment, if you think about education in general, how the whole media video consumption space works, or healthcare from a broader supply chain perspective, these are all industries ripe for, like the Uber one, ripe for model level innovation. Health and safety, for sure, another one. Travel agents already happened, right? We saw that. We saw that happen quickly. I give a speech at the International Hoteliers Travel Agent thing in London 20 years ago, just 20 years. And I got booed when I said this was going to have a model change. I said, no, that'll never happen. You're an idiot. These things happen faster, faster than you think. So let's jump on to the next slide and I'll demystify a couple of things. So what is 5G and why does it matter in three slides? So let's jump to the next one. So really, why is 5G like rugby or running a commercial kitchen? I played a little bit of rugby when I was a kid very badly. Luckily, I was very fast, so that helped. And I ran a commercial kitchen at a fancy restaurant for several years. So I could actually do a PowerPoint and explain the fundamentals of these and then explain what you really need to focus on. What are the interrelated parts? Here's how you do the prep session before you open the kitchen. And then here's how you run a large commercial kitchen. And you would get it, right? It's not conceptually very complicated, but then I could put you in a bus and take you down to West 17th Street in New York, put you inside my favorite Italian restaurant, go here, okay, run the kitchen. And it would be a nightmare and a disaster. Same thing if I took you and put you on the rugby field. It's because while 5G is conceptually simple, it's just really, really hard to do because it's a practical thing and it's radically different, right? Rugby looks a little bit like American football, radically different. Commercial kitchen looks a little bit like the kitchen you have at home, whole different ballgame. So one of the reasons we've gone in at the deep end of the pool on 5G with these very difficult to engineer stadiums, and one of the reasons we went first is we wanted to get that practical knowledge, the bumps, the bruises, the dirt under the fingernails, the muscle memory to go and drive this. And that's us as the network experts. We feel the same way for our partners who are then going to take the things we build on top of 5G and the new capabilities of 5G to go do that. So it's a practical thing. Getting experience out ahead of your competition really, really matters. And we're super proud to work with the VA because they are ahead of anybody else stepping up and saying, hey, look, this, we know this is going to be important. We know that this is something we've got to get our hands on. Let's go light up some locations. Let's get going, right? And it's just awesome to see folks with that kind of damn the torpedoes approach to the future and jumping into the deep end of the pool on innovation. So two more slides on 5G to demystify what it is. So you can think of 5G as two things. If you jump to the next slide for me. So the radio networks are just pipes, right? Networks are pipes in the ground or on poles, which are largely fiber, and then pipes in the air, which are radios, right? The radio part changes radically with 5G, what you can do through the air. It's these eight components, which we call the currencies or the capabilities. Each one of these is between, at a minimum, 10, and at the high end, 1,000x better than 4G. So that's a huge step up. But there's a couple of things in here that are radically different. The latency, which is how quickly you get a response, is single-digit milliseconds. So single-digit milliseconds, a blink of the eye is 300 milliseconds. So that's really real time. So now you can do things. You can go back to compute, process something, get the answer, and do that in what a human would perceive as real time. It's especially important for AR and VR overlays, because if you're motion sensing and your visual cortex get out of sync, your body thinks it's been poisoned. And what does your body do when it thinks it's been poisoned? It throws up. So maybe not the best product guy on earth, but I know if my product includes "and it'll make you puke," probably not super useful. You solve that with super low latency. But look, this is only half of the story. Maybe the more important half of the story is on the next slide if we jump to that. So on top of the amazing things it'll do through the air, because it's a software-defined cloud-native network, that's techno-gobbledygook for the edge of the computer, the edge of the network becomes a bog-standard containerized compute. So it's like having all of those attributes I just talked about with a supercomputer in your back pocket. So I can literally get fed data through a camera or through sensors and run an ML process, a machine learning process against it, detect patterns, detect an opportunity or a defect or a problem, and respond back to you in 30 milliseconds. That's 1/10 of a blink of an eye. So that can be super useful in out in the real world, which my entire experience of the real world is it actually happens in real time, especially opportunities, be those positive positive or negative. One of my favorite quotes there at the bottom from one of the best engineers on the planet, Alan Kay, who was also at Xerox PARC during its heyday. He said, look, context is worth 80 IQ points. And what happens when we bring customers into our labs and we get our hands on 5G, it always turns into, okay, that's super cool, really like the platforms, but you know what? Here's what I would do with that. So again, to the partnering conversation, the addition of context and the actual know-how of around your current environment, plus these platforms, is where real innovation will start to percolate. So let's jump on to the next slide. And I'll blast through the end of this. Look, three examples of platforms that are already out there. These have been in our labs for a long time. They're out with customers in alpha, only capable because of the combination of compute at the edge and what the network will do. So think of a 5G network as part of your compute topology. Think of it as connectivity plus platforms plus solutions. Three platforms here, a dumb camera turns into intelligence. That can be me looking down the aisle of a retail environment and doing real-time shelf level inventory, doing real-time demand shaping, doing heat mapping of folks moving around. Use the same camera for monitoring patients, monitoring, including you know spectral sensing from the camera, monitoring changes in patterns, monitoring human flows, finding defects in circuit boards at a big manufacturer. If you can think it, full detection, full prevention, if you can think it and we can model it visually, we can do the processing at the edge. Here's one that I think is really important, especially for asset intensive industries like healthcare sectors. This is simply taking what we know about AI and ML and big data and moving it to the edge so that I can do that processing in real time and I can be predictive and proactive and pattern matched and preventative and precise in real time. Third one is immersive creation and consumption. I get a little pushback on this one, like, yeah, I'm not sure we're really going to adopt AR and how would that really work? But if you think about it happening in real time and you think about it happening in a working environment, in a healthcare scenario, all of the records could pop up in the air, the intelligence to find contraindications quickly, the capability to overlay, I think as Jessica was talking on the last panel, we're partners on that solution to overlay visuals like really fat files like MRI or CAT scans over patients in real time. These things will really matter. Pokemon Go, which is not super useful in healthcare, nor in my business, it's actually not even really complicated AR technology. 50 million users in 19 days. So what if you had something that was truly beneficial, that was really precise, that was really pattern matched and really personalized? What would that be, right? What's the adoption curve of that? I don't know, but I know it's better than Pokemon Go. So that's my little proof point on that one. So let's jump ahead and run this to the end. And then I want to bring in Dr. Vega for some comments. These platforms that I just described, yeah, you can go straight to there. The platforms I described are actually also different economics for your CIOs. Because typically I was a CIO at several giant companies, and every time you have a problem, there's a tech kit of software and hardware to solve that problem. And the next problem has this, and different departments all use different kit, and there's no reusing stuff, very, very rarely. The descriptions of those three platforms I give examples across industries, the front of the house, the back of the house, in the hands of patients. These are platforms that live on top of connectivity that then have micro solutions on top of them. That's a different set of economics, a different set of fungibility for CIOs. And these are just examples of the same platforms in radically different settings. So jump on to what's next. This is one that we're super proud of. This is a brain surgeon and a radiologist that somehow went home to their parents and said, thanks for putting me through med school. I'm going to work out of a closet at Toby's lab and build this next gen AR capability for surgery. And the company's called Medivis, and they've built this amazing tool that layers MRI and CAT scan type data on top of the patient, and has a fantastic time saving and quality improvement component. Impossible to do this without the right latency and bandwidth and compute at the edge. Really, really difficult. I think it's part of an emerging field called IPAE, which is immersive participative audience engagement. And if you think as the surgeon, as part of the engagement team, and you think across healthcare, there's lots and lots of key elements where if I could have precise visual AR and VR capabilities, that you would change a lot of engagements. If we jump to the next slide. Telemedicine, teleoperations, I don't think we have to sell this one. Although, you know, a year ago, if you polled 100 doctors, about 80 of them would have gone, yeah, you know, there's nothing like the face-to-face. This, you know, you're never going to get there from here. I think one of the things we're finding, and this is a key element of digitization, is once you go digital, there are things that you can do, from simple queuing, from job management, from putting in layers, that are actually more efficient. So I think this is here to stay. You're going to see digital components there. I think one of the big barriers in healthcare is getting people to get through the barrier of actually engaging. I'm very bad at that. Not really with all healthcare, just the dentist. But getting folks to engage and finding easier ways, especially to go up through the healthcare environment and go horizontally to my peer community. And there's some wonderful peer communities out there, especially in the cancer area, in the Asperger's community, super, super useful lay communities out there. But again, we see this taking off. We invested and bought a company called Blue Jeans in great part to go charging down this path. And if you think about these sort of platforms and capabilities, not only are they good for telemedicine, teleoperations, I think they're going to become the fabric of operating, whether it's the factory floor or a big stadium or an airport or running a giant healthcare center like the beautiful VA center down in Lake Nona. Why wouldn't everybody working there carry around something that is video and image capable with AR layers? So when I get stuck on something, I can say, hey, Dr. Vega, what do you think of this? Take a look at that, whether he's next door or in California or in DC. So I do think that's going to be important. So jump me over to the next slide, and we'll see if we can bring this to a close. I'd like to thank the VA for their partnership and just the, you know, extending our boundaries and bringing that deep smart context to our technology side of the fence with their healthcare and technology horsepower. And I can't overemphasize how important a little bit of humility is for the innovation equation, and I'm proud to work at a company although it's funny that you put pride and humility in the same sentence, I'm proud to work for a company that says, look, we don't really know all of these answers. We are not going to be healthcare domain experts, no matter how many healthcare people we hire. And we've got a bunch of good vertical healthcare people. It's the ability to listen, engage, and co-construct and fail rapidly with our partners that I think really matters. And I couldn't find a better one than the folks that have shown up with Dr. Vega and the fine folks at the VA. So thank you for that. And I'll turn it over to Dr. Vega.
Hey, Toby, thanks so much for sharing that with us. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
You know, one of the things I think that's remarkable about 5G is that it brings such a new level of practicality to the innovations, right? So, you know, folks ask us about the Metaverse Microsoft project. They say, well, can't you run this on Wi-Fi? I think the answer is yes, but, you know, my friend Joe Grace would probably agree with me. It's a lot different. I want you to use this incredible technology. It's going to help you navigate surgery better, but you know, we got to warn you, it may pixelate or it may jump, right? The latency may not be there for what surgeon's going to say, oh, you know, let me try this out, right? So as great as the technology is, there's a practicality of the innovation that has to exist in order for it to be adopted, right? I know somebody was telling me it would be the equivalent of Uber saying you can only access ride shares from certain lampposts strategically placed around town. I mean, how many people would actually use it? So the convenience and the optimization of it, and I think, you know, when you and I talk about what's next, what does that new frontier look like, it's how do we bring people together to not only advance the practicality of the solutions, but do the co-development, the co-design to understand the impact on workflows and how we actually get these solutions into the hands of providers and patients in a way that's actually going to drive adoption.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I think it's that, you know, get in the kitchen, get on the playing field. The old Thomas Edison saying that, you know, that innovation's 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration, right? It's doing the work. And look, and it's fun work to do because you get discoveries, you get impact. And what better area to do it in than healthcare, right? It's not like we're trying to, you know, make another set of shoes or better roller skates. This is healthcare. This is human beings. So yeah, I'm just delighted to be part of this.
And I think the opportunity that really lies ahead of us, if you look at what's happening, particularly in the area of Lake Nona, where you have this conglomerate of folks coming together with really unique backgrounds, sort of a diversity of opinion, really, whether it's engineers and providers and patients alike. And I think the key for us to really be successful and to push the boundaries are going to be coming in, and I love how you sort of talk about the humility of innovation, because I think it's going to be important to come in not with a preconceived notion of what the solution is, but really a willingness to push and explore what problem are we actually trying to solve. And then solving that problem together, bringing the diversity of viewpoints, gets us to an actually solution that will solve the problem that we intended. You know, I see so many times the innovation is all about the object or the technology, and it's really looking for a problem to solve. We haven't taken a step back to say, how do we bring diversity of viewpoints together to really ideate around what the problem is? And I, you know, we heard from Dean Kamen earlier, who really brings that engineering viewpoint and lens to problem solving and ideation. And I think that becomes so incredibly important. So Toby, we have just valued our relationship with you all. I think we've learned a lot, not only in the partnership through Project Convergence, but I know there's some exciting things we have intended for the future as we sort of embark upon this innovation journey in the beginning. We're very fortunate to have you tonight. I know they were just telling me there's thousands of people sort of tuning in and watching. And so I think people are generally getting excited about what the next frontier of medicine looks like.
No, thanks for having me. And I'm really looking forward to the next phase down at Lake Nona, where we get pragmatism and innovation, marry those together in that amazing 5G space down there.
Yeah, I know we're going to be hearing a lot more about that over the coming months.
Greetings, everybody. I hope that you've had an absolutely fabulous time at the innovation experience. We've got a couple more things that we want to talk to you about. But earlier today, we had the innovation that came up where Dean Kamer and Chris Meeks were there. And Chris had to go out and take care of an incredibly important aspect of his life, which we've all learned to pay attention to. He had to go pick up his son. Nothing more important than family, friends, community, and our shipmates. So Chris, we actually wanted to bat it over to you so that you could take a little bit of credit for this incredible donation that you gave and this incredible gift that you've given to the VA. So Chris, over to you.
Thank you for that, and apologies. You know, the new norm is trying to figure out who's got kid pickup, and so we're just thankful their kids are in school being safe. So thanks for having me back. I think Dean was so excited to get to the fireside chat earlier. He forgot to pass the mic back over to me, so I appreciate the opportunity. First, I want to give a big shout out to Dr. Ryan Vega, Joshua Patterson, Kit Teague, and Mark Bolson. These have really been who I call my Sherpas within the innovation ecosystem and the VA system in general, helping us deploy revolutionary technology to our nation's heroes. So thank you for all the work that you've done and continue to do. And to your point here, Soldier Strong has had the privilege of working with Dean Kamen and DECA Research over the past 5 years, you know, specifically with the Luke arm, which is the only prosthetic arm with a full range of motion from the fingertips to the shoulder. Today, Dean rolled out the new iBot, and yes, there's a little pun intended there, and I'm honored to announce that Soldier Strong has committed to funding and donating 10 iBots to enable injured veterans to stand up and be eye level with the world again. So thank you again for the opportunity to make this announcement at this year's VHA Innovation Experience. Stay safe and God bless.
Chris, thank you so much. I got to tell you, the generosity and the technology and the incredible gift that you've given is going to make a difference for so many veterans. I just want to recap a little bit of today. We had a great experience kicking it off with Ms. Pam Powers. We had Dr. Carolyn Clancy. We had Dr. Lieberman. We had the great brain wake-up that we had from David Vibora. Dr. Ryan came in. We had Ken Kaiser, we had Carolyn Clancy, Pam Powers, Dr. Lieberman, Dean Kamer, Chris Meek. We also had Shark Tank's not until tomorrow. Well, why don't you just stick around? You can stick around for a little bit, but Shark, and a mask. I'm glad to see that you're socially distancing. I didn't know that sharks did that. That's fantastic. You like that?
That was pretty good.
It wasn't bad.
It was pretty good.
Tomorrow, we've got a great day. We have Shark Tank, where we're going to be having our great friends in the competition. These are innovations that come across from the VA, all over the VA. We're going to have some keynote speakers. We're going to have some exciting announcements that are going to come by. And we also have a keynote by Mark Johnson, who's the CEO of Innosight. Now, I also want you to get excited about
Shark Tank.
I just wanted to make sure you knew about it. Thanks very much. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow. Special thanks today also to Sarab, Jay Bat, Carissa, Jessica, Ryan, Martha, Andy, Stacy, and Aaron. Couldn't have done it without you. And to the Atlas team, Dr. Ryan, it's been a fabulous afternoon. This is Captain Grace signing off. Till tomorrow, 1300 Eastern Standard Time.